golf is technical, but it's also this human aspect of the game. And the super golfer is going to be the one who makes sure their mastery of the technical side, their mastery of the fitness side, their mastery of the human side, and they're expert as how to react to their golf shots, so they keep creating confidence, and they know how to manage themselves between shots, and they know what to do when all the variability happens that is part of the game. I mean, so the super golfer is the one that have realized, I need to master like both the human aspect of the game and the technical aspect of the game.
Golf Smarter, number 721. The critical elements that separates a super golfer from the rest of us, with Pia Nilsson.
This is Golf Smarter, sharing stories, tips, and insights from great golf minds to help you lower your score and raise your golf IQ. Here's your host, Fred Green.
Welcome back to the Golf Smarter podcast, Pia.
Hello, Fred. It's good to be here again.
It's great to have you back on, and we learned so much from Lynn. I can't wait to get started with you. But she told me to ask you the question of what 54 is all about and why it's an integral part of your program.
Yeah. So in my life before Vision 54, I was head coach of our national teams in Sweden. And when I started coaching there, I was heavily influenced by playing college golf in the U.S. and LPGA golf in the U.S. And I realized that when I started helping the younger players, that they had such limiting beliefs. They always had excuses. You know, the winters are so long in Sweden and our courses are not in great shape and it's so hard to become better or as good as other countries. And I was just feeling that we need to change the attitude. So me and a friend, Shell Enhager, who's written a great book called Quantum Golf, and we were talking and said, we need to like change how they're thinking. So we figured very many of these good national team players had made birdies on every hole on their home course at one time or another. So just to change the mindset, we started challenging them. Okay, so if they have made birdies on most of these holes, and some had even made eagles, like, what would it ever take to do it during the same round? So if it could ever happen in the future, how in the world would you do it? Because obviously you have done it, just not during the same round. So it just became a different way of thinking, because obviously 18 birdies on a par 72 hole, 72 courses, 54. So, and it was the smartest things we could have ever done, because we just started challenging them. Okay, so to go towards that and shoot 54 or even better, how do you need to swing? How do you need to practice? How do you need to think? And it became a mindset to go after and see where it can take you. And it had big implication for us as coaches, because if we're going to support players going towards 54, what do we need to know? How do we need to coach? And so it was in February 91, the first time we started talking about it. And you know, Annika Sorenstam took it to heart right away, and she always played with a 54 head cover. So, and that belief just stuck with us. So even when I started coaching and Lynn and I started working together, they always kept saying, you're the guys who believe in the 54, because Lynn had always been coaching towards possibilities as well. So we just couldn't get away from it, and we realized we actually love the thinking, because it is a number, it is 18 birdies, but it's even more whoever we come across, we want to look at their possibilities and help them access it.
Very good. I love the way you just kind of nonchalantly dropped in one of your students' name from your national Swedish team, who ended up being one of the greatest players of all time.
Yeah, that's
how
for sure.
How old was Annika when you started working with her?
Well, it was when I got back to Sweden and I just happened to fall into coaching. But so she was like 18 or 19, and you know, I feel very blessed that I got to be part of her coaching team her entire career, and you know, got to follow that and support her with many things as well. So that was an incredible experience.
You've got another teacher that works with your schools who also discovered a player at an early age, don't you?
Yeah, Rudy, you mean?
Yes, I do mean Rudy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Rudy Duran, he comes and supports us, especially with some of our golf schools, and he's so terrific to having him around, and he, with all his experience, and you know, it's really fun to hear him share stories from when Tiger was young.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm gonna pound your door one more time so I can see if we can get Rudy on the show as well.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. And do you, when you see an Annika at 18 years old and you're coaching in a country that is not, you know, a golf mecca, it's not a definitely a, not a, a golf destination for so many people in the world, when you see someone like that, she must just jump off, you know, she must stand out so strongly, or was she just raw and you just knew that there was something there?
Well, I think it's one of the hardest things ever in our game to try to guess who's going to be the next greatest player. You know,
guess who's going to win the next tournament.
I mean, exactly.
That's what gambling's about.
Who do you think is going to win next week? And obviously, how in the world would I know? Because you can have players who play so awesome Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, everything is in place, and then they miss the cut, and they have players who are hitting it all over the board, and suddenly, you know, it's very, very interesting. So the same goes with this. I'm very, very hesitant, you know, when many agents might ask me, Elaine, who's going to be the next greatest one. There's so many components. So same thing with, you know, with Annika, she did not stand out. She was, you know, she spoke about it earlier, you know, she was missing winning on purpose because she didn't want to win a victory speech. So actually, you know, I was helping her go because she wanted to go to college in the U.S. like I had, and it was really hard for some coaches to believe me that she was a great player because she hadn't been winning, and she hadn't been winning because she didn't dare to give a victory speech. So and she was in a group of, you know, 6 to 8 promising Swedish junior players, but she never stood out. She was never a star junior player. But when she was around, you know, 20, 21, things just started changing. She just had deeper motivation. Her work ethic was stronger, and she just, you know, took to heart some really, really great habits. But I don't think she could ever imagine how great she would be. I couldn't. I knew the possibilities were there, but there's no way to have known that beforehand. And that sometimes I think is the beauty that, you know, sometimes you can set goals. I want to win 5 tournaments in my life, or I want to be a tour player, or I want to be a single digit golfer, which is helpful for some. But the 54 vision is different because it's just keep acting on things under your control and see how low it can take you. So it's more an open-ended way of thinking. And Annika is definitely, you know, it's incredible, but there's no way anyone could have known it when she was younger. Mm. It just kept growing and growing and growing. And Lina have been fortunate. We've supported on the women's side 4 different world number one players. And, you know, it's hard to know beforehand who's going to be that good.
And which 4 were those? Besides
yes, Annika and Aimia Sato and Arya Jutanagarn. And Jan is saying we helped during some of her British Open wins. We didn't coach her a lot, but we coached her during those British Opens.
In the newest book, you talk about, which is Be a Player. You open up with awareness and how all the learning starts here. You don't talk about position, grip, and alignment. You know, you go into things like balance and tempo and tension.
Yeah, because, I mean, we don't find the need to write something 1,000 other people have written about, and many do it very, very well. So
good for you.
We wanted to write about things that we feel we can add to the game or add to the experience of the golfers. So that's why, you know, we're not 99%, we're 100% sure from all our experience how important it is to supplement technical skills with these other, what we call human skills or playing skills, skills you actually need to play the game. And we just think they're so undervalued. So that's why we put our effort in being creative, how we can, you know, hopefully, you know, make it more and more come alive. And it's not instead of technique, it's you need technique and these other skills. And when it comes to opening up with awareness, yes, because no matter what swing theory you have or putting theory you have or what you're working on, you need to have some degree of being actually present to what you're doing when you play golf, because you can't like see a golf shot clearly unless you're like aware and present, or you can't feel a turn in your body if you're not actually more present and aware. And we just feel in today's world with all the technology and the speed of life and speed of everything that we see so many golfers that are, they just think golf, they're like up in their heads and they're so hurried and fast, so they can't improve because they're not actually aware of what they're doing when they're stroking a putt or making a golf swing. So we think it's something that's always been important in golf, and we just feel in today's world we just need a little bit more practice from being at the office or school or whatever things we've been doing that makes us rushed and maybe too much in the future or past. We're not like present to what we're doing. So doing a few awareness exercises just gets you back to being more athletic, and it's more possible to make the swings you want to make.
We're going to take a quick time out. We'll be right back. Pia, I'm not trying just to go from chapter to chapter on this book, but there's things about it that just I find so interesting, unique, and important. Because on these podcasts, when I do stuff on swing mechanics, we get our highest number of downloads. But when we talk about strategic and mental and on the course and things like that are not just mechanics, I have more fun. I learn so much more and get so much more out of it for when I'm out on the golf course. And I really love to focus on that kind of content. So on chapter 2 of this book, it's Welcome to the Game of Golf. Are you emphasizing game there?
Well, we are emphasizing game. And I think, you know, Lynn mentioned too that we just feel, you know, we advance so enormously much in technology and technique and learning about the body swing connection, which is terrific. But we can't forget the whole point of it is that I can actually perform out on the golf course. And we feel that has been a missing piece for many. They think it's a mystery that they're on the range working and having great teaching aids and hit it great. And then they go on the golf course and nothing works. And they think there's something wrong. There is not. So we don't want to take away all the great development. We think it's fantastic, but we can't forget that the bigger purpose is to play golf and golf course. And we need to realize what that's like. And it's very, very different from being on a putting green or a driving range. So that's where we go from, you know, you need to be aware of what you're doing. And then you need to make sure that you train things the way game is actually played on the golf course.
You mentioned Shell Enhanger earlier. Tell me more about his influence on your teaching.
Yeah. Well, you know, I've been very blessed to have extraordinary influencers in my life. And I think, you know, I'm both Lynn and myself, you know, lifelong, forever learners. And we, you know, reading and going to seminars, and I never stopped to do that, but Kjell definitely, we're the same age. And when I started coaching in Sweden, and I looked for some more support more the mental performance side of golf, and I hadn't been pleased with how we used to do things. And then someone just told me, there's this guy I know who I think you should talk to. So it was just a coincidence. And when we connected and talked for 3 hours, we realized that his experience, what he knew about human performance, and he's a good golfer, and he'd been a golf pro for a little while, but he was mostly helping corporate leaders, or started doing that. And then we just joined up and decided let's check some of these things out together, how we can more modernize the non-technical side of golf. So for a couple of years, we worked super closely and in creating, making that 54 vision really come alive. So for me, it's he was really good at pushing me, because I've always been kind of a shy introvert, and he really helped me a lot just to dare to speak out a little bit more and have more courage in what I was doing.
That's beautiful. What frustrates you about current day instruction?
Well, what?
Because you have these students that come to you and say, "Well, my last teacher told me that."
But it is more, and you mentioned it before. It's this dualistic view that still exists, that people think, and there can still be all the social media discussions, even from, you know, many teachers, is golf technical or mental, and it drives me absolutely crazy because it's both, of course, and a lot more, because obviously we can't play golf without knowing how to swing a club or make a stroke with a putter and hit from different lies and different shots. It's obvious, but we can't play golf without ourselves either. So for me, it just gets frustrated that we still have to spend so much energy talking about what is more important when it's impossible to answer. It's technical, and it's what we now call this more, you know, human skills, because it is still a human being who makes the golf swing. So I just work on my patience till we can find a place that we can just more integrate it. Of course it's technical, but of course it's these non-technical skills as well, and that they get more equal treatment. But it is trickier, because of course the technical side I can always prove through, you know, 3D analysis or video camera or TrackMan. I mean, I can get numbers, I can get facts on it. So it's much more, you know, tangible, and I can show it in magazine, I can show it on television and draw lines, and it's much more visible. The non-technical factors are more hidden, so people dismiss them, but it doesn't mean they're not equally important, because you can't put a measurement on how much I trust a decision or, you know, my exact tension level on my body when I'm swinging on a tight fairway or something like that. But it doesn't mean it's not equally important to other things. So it's just staying patient till we can have more honor that the golf fundamentals are wider than technical. They are technical, but they're non-technical fundamentals too. And there are some things that are important that we can measure. There are some things that are important that they're more subjective, but they're really, really important to enjoy the game and play well. So I always talk. So if we feel so strongly about it, we just need to get more creative and express things better or have better exercises. So more and more, you know, golfers can experience the beauty of the game, and it's bigger than only technical.
Yeah,
it is technical, but it's not only that.
Right, it's extremely technical, but
but
when that gets caught in your head, it's counterproductive.
And it's not always the head, you know, and that's what we want to get away from. It's not always the head. It's for many golfers, it's in the body, meaning that they're. The tension level gets tight and they have never thought about it, and that affects the technique right away, or their tempo is inconsistent on the course. It's not mental, it's in the body, but it's shows up in the technique. So that's why it can be mental, but it can be just the physical state of the body, or it can be your emotional state. So the reason we call it the human state instead of mental, because it's more than mental.
Absolutely,
and when any of those things go off, if you get distracted by someone talking, or if you get too tight in your shoulders, it's always manifest in the technique. So, of course, it is true. Anytime I miss a golf shot, I can prove that something technical happened, but it's not always the technique's fault. So, that reality is where we need to get our head around.
Yeah, Pia, you're absolutely wrong. It's always the technique's fault.
Well, it is. So actually, everything we do is technical because mm-hmm. everything we do influences the technique.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
I loved the first couple books so much. I really would love to spend a moment on like just the title of Every Shot Must Have a Purpose. You know.
Yeah.
And we've heard people talk about practice with a purpose. That word keeps yep. coming back up, and your intention of what you're going to do, not just get up there and hit the ball, right?
Yes. Oh, yeah. It's so true. And, you know, just go to many ranges and so many players are just mindlessly hitting balls without actually, like you said, without actually having an intention, a clear purpose why they're doing it.
Right.
So, yeah.
It gets frustrating. But then the second book, Game Before the Game, again, it's much more than just hitting a ball.
Yeah, no, exactly. And it's for those, you know, many play golf and they don't really care about that game before the game because they don't practice, that's why our last book is so important. But many do practice, and then you need to understand more all the things you can choose to practice and then how you go about it in the smartest way possible.
Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to take one more short break, and then I'm going to try to ask you something this is something I've not done before, but I'm going to go ahead and do it right after this. Pia, in talking to both you and Lynn, it brings back a question that I've already brought up, a listener question that I've brought up before in a different interview, but I think it's perfect to bring this up to you now. From Lamar Kersey, he says, do you think there's any link between being confident to spine angle and posture? He says, think about this. When we're confident, we always play better. We also unconsciously stand up a little straighter and push our chest out just a little bit more. When we're not confident, yeah. we tend to slouch. We roll our shoulders forward. We put more weight, put our weight a little more over our toes when we walk. So have you ever considered what that impact has, the your confidence level and the physical, and how that impacts your game? Because we all know that when you play with confidence, you're going to play great.
Absolutely. And both Lynn and I 100% agree that the state of our body and our body language is enormously important. So we have something we call, just to help golfers, we say, call it my 54, not 54. So my 54 are the things each player is doing when he or she plays really great. And then the not 54 is how we get in our own way. And these can be physical things, technical things, mental things, emotional things. But just about every player, when we ask them, you know, what's your body like when you're really confident and playing well? And of course, just about everybody straightens up and their head is up and they walk like looking like a champion. And then we ask them, so what happens when you lose it, when you're like, you know, hitting the downward spiral? And, you know, very many, you start looking down and, you know, your posture totally changes. So we have, you know, for all the years of coaching, had this as part of our focus. So there are many, many players that when they don't play well, the first thing they go to is just at least when you walk between shots, keep your head up and shoulders back and be an actor and actress and have the body language of how you are when you are confident, and they feel things changing. Or some even walking into the shot, they just beef up their body language some. So, I mean, our bodies are not, once again, separate, like the technical, mental, physical, all of it in the body is integrated. So how my body is affects my brain, and it's going to affect my technique, and how my brain is going to affect my body. It all goes together. So I 100% agree with that. Mm-hmm. And I know there's been plenty of research done on the importance of the body language to how we actually feel about ourselves.
Oh, well, that was one of his questions. Is there research? Can we find we can find some information on that.
Maybe I'll
talk to you after we do the recording and see if we can find that research. But now I want to get back to the more current book.
And actually, it is. It's yes. One of them is Amy Cuddy, C-U-D-Y, and she and a group of others. But there are many other ones, too, that have done research on it.
Oh, wow. All right. Great. Yeah? Thank you. But let's go back to the more recent book, excuse me, about Be a Player. And I want to focus, if we can, to wrap this up on chapters 8 and 9, because 8 would be your mind, managing your self-talk, which my worst language is when I'm talking to myself. And then we'll get into your emotions and resilience and catching yourself mid-screw-up. I love that concept. But let's go to managing your self-talk, chapter 8 here, your mind.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the things, you know, we are in a 100-meter race in track and field, there's not going to be a lot of self-talk happening during those seconds. But, you know, in golf, we have enormously much time between shots, like whatever, 4.5 hours plus. And golfers in general talk a lot to themselves. So, you know, I don't know, there are thousands and thousands of thoughts that every golfer has in their brain between shots. And sometimes it's just good to check up on that, if what I'm saying to myself is helping me or hurting me. And we just found that many golfers self-sabotage. And so it's just being aware of that and learning actually how you can be between shots if you want to without having chatter in your brain, or if you have chatter in the brain that you can, for yourself and no one else should decide, but you can more train yourself, how do I want to talk to myself, and just create new habits with that. It's extremely important, because you know what we repeatedly say to ourselves can end up being what we actually believe.
yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that's true.
And then we move on to our emotions. And what does that mean? Catching yourself mid screw up. Usually, that's
it's the same thing. You know, game is a golf, obviously, with a lot of talk in our head, and golf is a game with a lot of emotions, from euphoria, happiness, to despair and frustration, and we usually experience a lot of that during every round we play. So, and all the research on emotional states and how much it actually affects our bodies and affect our brain and affect our performance, it's you know, that's what's fun now, the last 20 years, how much more research is being done on that. So it's, we know that when I keep, if I keep on having a lot of negative emotions over time, it shuts down access to our higher brain function. And that's why in things outside of golf, road rage happens, or test anxiety and all kinds of things. We just, like, you know, the brain can't function. And so golf gets very emotional for many players. So learning some management of the emotions in golf becomes very, very important, and even more for those that compete.
Mm-hmm. Well, on your website, you refer to the super golfer as a goal for everybody. Not whom, and not specific. Let's start with, what is a super golfer? And then we'll get about achieving that.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, the super golfer would be the one that actually realized that golf is technical, but it's also this human aspect of the game. And the super golfer is going to be the one who makes sure their mastery of the technical side, their mastery of the, you know, fitness side, their mastery of the human side, and the management, and, you know, simplify that they're expert at every shot they hit forever, that they're committed and decisive, and they've trained it so much that they that's what they're always going to do, and that they're always focused in every golf swing and present and engaged till the end of the motion. And they're expert as how to react to their golf shots, so they keep creating confidence, and they know how to manage themselves between shots, and they know what to do when all the variability happens that is part of the game. So the super golfer is the one that have realized, I need to master, like, both the human aspect of the game and the technical aspect of the game.
It's kind of like going into the zone, right? It's not something you plan on. It's like, I'm going to be in the zone today's round of golf. It's kind of like when you walk away from it, like, whoa, I was really on it today.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
And it's the kind of thing you don't want to question while it's going on, because as soon as you do, you start losing
it. Exactly.
You lose it, right? Because you're thinking about it then.
I know. So what we want is just to increase the probability of that being able to occur. We can never guarantee it, but we can increase the probability that you can access that more often. That's what we want.
Has anybody done it that you've seen?
Well, I think Annika is the one that's been closest to it. You know, when she shot her 59 and she started with 8 straight birdies, and then she started to question that it was too good to be true, and she got out of it, but then she got herself back. But I've seen players do it, but I think the super golfer for the future, we haven't seen yet, but she would probably still be the one that has been closest to it. And of course, we have a few other players now that are tapping into it more and more. So, and they're still younger, so we'll see what happens.
I am so happy to hear that Annika was on a tremendous roll, and then she started questioning it. And nothing against Annika, but it's like, you know, it's like if I'm playing well, and it's like, yeah, but this can't last, right? I just thought it was me, or you know, the average golfer that does that. But even superstars and super golfer like Annika was like questioning how successful she was at that moment.
Well, when if you start with 8 birdies and then you realize, like, I have never done this before, huh?
Right.
You know? Anyway, so it doesn't have to be doubt, but yeah, making it more conscious, and then it's harder to get back to the being in the state of the flow.
I guess so. Wow. Vision54.com. All the books.
Yeah.
We've talked about it. Let me remind everyone the names of the books one more time. Every Shot Must Have a Purpose, Game Before the Game, Play Your Best Golf Now, and the new one, Be a Player.
Be a player.
Yes. What's the final piece of advice you want to give us about be a player?
Well, it's to do the exercises in the book on the golf course, because we've seen such magic happen, and many golfers can start coaching and manage themselves, and many don't know yet how good their swings are till they beef up these other skills. So it's just do some of that, and it can never hurt your game. It can only help your game.
Mm-hmm. And the subtitle being so important of Be a Player is a breakthrough approach to playing better on the golf course. Not just playing better golf, but playing better golf on the golf course. That's the key element to this.
That's key. Not you know, we care very much less about how anyone hits it on the range, but we care about what happens when we go on the golf course.
It's perfect. Pia, it was so great to talk to you again. Thanks so much for your time and being on the show.
Yeah. Thank you, Fred, and thanks for all the good questions.
And so this is Christmas. I hope you have fun. The near and the dear ones. The old and the young.
Ho, ho, ho. Well, there's nothing I'd rather do right now than sneak down someone's chimney, and you know, I'm not into chimney soot. So I'll just knock at your podcast door to deliver some wonderful holiday cheer and a fabulous present into your life. Especially John Ward from Millersville, Pennsylvania. Because John, did I catch your attention? You're the winner of a brand new customized SeeMore putter from either their Classic Collection or the Mini Giant Series. And let me tell you right now, John, by this time next year, you're going to report back to me the difference that your SeeMore putter has made in your game, your scores, and definitely your confidence. Congratulations, John, and thanks so much for entering. And to all of you who've entered throughout the year, I really appreciate your support. Listen, if this interview with Pia Nilsson has inspired you and you're burning for more insights and instruction from her, then you'll definitely want to check out this week's episode number 37 of Golf Smarter Mulligans, which was our first interview with Pia. The episode is called Every Golf Shot Must Have a Purpose. Golf Smarter Mulligans is brought to you by twoguyswithgolfballs.com. Well, this is a pretty radical move for me, but this is actually going to be our last show for 2019, as I'll be skipping next week and not have new content for Golf Smarter. But we will have a new episode of Mulligans as we start the new decade. In 2 weeks, I'll be coming back for a new year and start off with our 10th annual Maddie B Awards. As in past years, we let our friend Maddie Blake, who's a TV show host, radio personality, and stand-up comic, we're going to let him loose and reflect and skewer on the past year's 2019 PGA Tour season. It's a lot of fun, and you won't want to miss it as we kick off year number 15 of Golf Smarter. So let me wish you a happy Hanukkah, a Merry Christmas, and a very happy, healthy, and three-putt-free new year. If you enjoyed another full year of Golf Smarter, could you please let other podcast listeners know about us with a review from wherever you find your favorite podcasts? And stay in touch with me, please, at Golf Smarter on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And also, if you'd like to check out my photography, I've been doing a photo of the day on Instagram at fgreencreative. And green is G-R-E-E-N-E. F is in Fred. Green Creative. F Green Creative. If you have any questions, comments, or suggestions, I love hearing from you. Please click on the Hey Fred button at golfsmarter.com. Happy New Year.